Welcome to our quick introduction on what K3s is and how it differs from regular Kubernetes. So there are a lot of misconceptions about what K3s is, but it's important to make clear that it's not a fork. A fork would imply diverging code bases from a common point, and in fact the opposite is true. The best analogy is to consider it a distribution of Kubernetes. The same code that powers all the individual daemons in Kubernetes is the same as in K3s. K3s just takes all the same software and packages it differently, in a similar way to Linux distributions, all including a lot of common tools but with their own package management. The key three philosophies of K3s are that it's lightweight, a single binary which takes around 50 megabytes, and it has low resource usage, taking up about 300 megabytes of RAM as a bare minimum. Compatibility. It's a fully CNCF certified Kubernetes distribution, secure by default and with best practices by default. And it has an opinionated ethos. Pretty much Darren's decision is final and it's complete. Everything you need is packaged in and it's a single, simple binary. For those of you that don't know, K3s was never intended as a product in its own right. Rancher was building Rio, which is their platform as a service on Kubernetes, and wanted an easy way of bundling Kubernetes with Rio. Then they decided to fork it out of there and launched it as K3s. So it was more of an accidental project rather than a planned from scratch system. Rancher took all of the different processes that form Kubernetes and built them into a single binary, made possible using Go's lightweight Go routines. They then took that combined source code set and cross-compiled it to ARM, so that you can run it on ARM servers or even Raspberry Pis. There are a lot of third-party storage providers in the main Kubernetes source code, so they don't compile those in, instead relying on supporting those that are CSI compliant. There are also a lot of integrations with cloud providers in the source tree, so they drop those too. For those of you that had followed guide like Kelsey Hightower's Kubernetes the Hard Way, security in the communication through the Kubernetes control plane is a big part of it. But K3s automates all of that and automatically manages rotating the certificates when required too. Finally, you don't even need much on your base operating system because all the standard Linux user space tools are bundled in from BusyBox. If you put any YAML manifest files in a particular folder on your server, they will be automatically installed when you install K3s. You can also use any of the most common databases as a back-end storage because Rancher replaced etcd with Kine. The default is SQLite, but if you use a proper database such as MySQL or PostgreSQL, then it can scale really well. Rancher believes potentially even better than using etcd. With the release of Helm 3, this is less important, but even before Helm 3 removed the requirement for Tiller, K3s had a custom resource for Helm chart installations. This is still available, which means that you can easily install Helm charts without needing the client installed on your local machine, or the CI machine. They also took the opportunity to bundle a few components that are commonly installed in clusters, core DNS, the metric server, and traffic, as an opinionated choice of ingress controller. So after all of that, that's a lot of custom code and patches to maintain against upstream, right? Well, as of 1.0, it's just 1,000 lines of code. This is due to some great work from K3s developers, some upstream patches being accepted, as well as natural changes from the upstream source. It wasn't always this way, though. The first public release of K3s over a year ago had 3 million lines of changes. Installing K3s is really easy. You can either use their get script to download the latest binary, configure it in it, or system scripts and get it up and running, or you can simply download the latest binary and execute it yourself. So to summarize, K3s is better than regular Kubernetes in the following ways. Has a small binary with low resource requirements. A single master or node is possible, making it a great use case for edge computing. It's easy to install and the clusters launch really quickly. All of the dependencies are bundled up in one single binary. And there's bundled goodness in terms of the default things that a lot of clusters will use out of the box. These make it a great choice for the following situations: development environments for local development, test environments for launching during continuous integration and continuous delivery platforms, experiments such as can I configure Kubernetes to do X, Y, and Z at the same time, or even learning when you're first getting started with Kubernetes or a given Kubernetes-based technology. Compared to the likes of Amazon and Google clusters, by using K3s, we've got some great launch times. But this year, one of our goals is to push these even faster with a new platform we're in the middle of developing. We currently achieve 85% of our cluster launches in under 3 minutes, and 95% of them launch under 5 minutes. Next year, we're aiming to get 95% of our clusters to launch in under 1 minute. Just before we end, while I was away in San Diego at KubeCon in November 2019, we got this amazing tweet from a member of our community. He didn't want to call out the competitor in the tweet, but this was one of my favourite moments. So, if you want to have a play with it, feel free to check out our beta-managed K3s service, and you get $70 per month in credit against your clusters. We also have an open-source marketplace for easy installation of things like Minio, OpenFaz, Linkerd, or Mesh, if you want to play with those things. Just check us out at civo.com/cube100.